Thanks for joining in for this very important session. I guess we've all been trying to get our heads around leading virtual teams operating in the virtual environment. And just this morning, in case you didn't notice, MS Teams had an outage and that put the world in a tailspin. Very ironic to be doing a leading virtual team session on a day when this had to happen. Anyway, so that's our reality today. And we are extremely excited to launch this new product from Nolscape on leading virtual teams. So without much further ado, let me go ahead and share my screen with you. We've got an exciting session lined up for you. Allow me a moment to navigate this. I hope you can see my screen. Just some ground rules before we get started. Please feel free to use the chat window in case you would like to communicate, in case there are questions being asked, if you'd like to participate, use the chat window. But in case you have a question that you would like to ask the guest speaker, the moderator, or our product team, please use the Q&A chat window, right? Just the Q&A section of Zoom, right? With that housekeeping done, let me quickly get started with a session today. We are launching a new product called Leading Virtual Teams. We are extremely excited. This is, in fact, a topic that came out on the top of our list when we did our research. In fact, last year, when we asked our industry friends, colleagues, professionals, leaders, what are the top 10 topics that they were tracking, this came right on top. So here we are with a product from Nolscape on the same topic. So this is what we have in store for you. First, I'd like to quickly introduce Nolscape to all of you. And then we have an exciting speaker, Kapil, who's going to give us his industry perspective on virtual teams and the impact of virtual teams on businesses. And then I'll pass this on to Kalyan, our Chief Product Officer, to walk you through our simulation. And then towards the end, we'll have a Q&A. Right, so we'll get started with the first item on the list. To begin with, my own introduction. My name is Rajiv Jayaraman. I'm the founder and CEO of Nolscape. And Nolscape as an organization is all about helping organizations and leaders become future ready through experiential learning. We fundamentally believe that traditional learning models are not good enough for the digital age. We need an immersive learning environment that accelerates employee transformation and builds digital mindsets. So our rapid upskilling approach has two components to it, two value propositions, if you will. One for the learner, where we create deep immersive technology-led experiences. And for the organization, whatever we do at scale, and we provide in-depth talent intelligence. So this has been widely regarded in the industry. We've been winning Brandon Hall Awards, Versinbyte, Deloitte recognition, and we are a top 20 gamification company globally. And from a solution perspective, there are two areas we focus on. One is called Leading Now, the other is called Leading Next. Leading Now is a set of competencies that individuals, managers, and leaders need as of today to run their show. And Leading Next is all about building digital mindsets, right? And today's session, interestingly, although it is Leading Next, is also soon becoming part of Leading Now because this is the new normal. Right, these are some organizations that we have worked with globally. Large global multinationals is our sweet spot. 300 plus organizations, 75 countries. We have strategic partnerships with many top tier B schools and consulting firms. And in a given year, we touch close to 400,000 learners. Right, so that's a scale at which we are operating. And what is unique about Nolscape is obviously the immersive learning experience. That's a quick sample of some of our simulations that some of you may be familiar with. Spanning across Leading Now and Leading Next, Leading Teams, Leading Change, Building Trust, Design Thinking, Agile. These are some very popular simulations that organizations worldwide are leveraging to build critical talent. And data visualization was a more recent addition to our portfolio and driving digital transformation as well. So while that's great for the learner from an immersive learning experience perspective, what is great in the back end is we are able to harness a lot of data around how people play the simulations. And using that data, we are able to create a talent intelligence report that captures essentially, what comes out of the product, what comes out of the platform, what comes out in terms of people's skills, right? And so that's essentially a comprehensive talent intelligence report we are able to create. And this data can be benchmarked against business units, organizations, and even industries. It helps organizations determine the readiness levels of people for critical emerging roles. Right, so that's on the talent analytics. So that was very quickly what I wanted to share with you about Nolscape. We have global presence. We have presence in 4 countries, and you know, growing really well and doing very interesting work both on the leadership side as well as the future skills side. Now, you know, the next segment is very interesting, where you know, we have a pretty interesting speaker, right? A guest speaker. Kapil Khaneja. Kapil, thank you so much for taking this time to participate in this product launch event. Kapil is a global leader and India head for British Telecom. And in this role, he is responsible for the organization's long-term strategic plans, along with day-to-day operations for customer management contact center vertical across various customer-facing units. And he oversees the development, communication, execution of organization's strategy across key pillars: people and work environment, operational excellence, customer experience, risk and compliance, and so on. And in his earlier stint as the AVP at HCL, he had global responsibility of client relationships. And telecom seems to be his calling, right, both at BT and earlier. And prior to that, he was at Convergys as a director of operations and a site leader, where he took complete responsibility, end-to-end responsibility for his program across 2 sites in India. And he has had, you know, span across Northern Ireland and Philippines as well. So incredibly delighted to have you on this product launch event, Kapil. Thanks for taking this time. Welcome to this event. Kapil, can you hear us? You may be on mute. I can't hear you. Can't you hear you yet, Kapil? You talk about virtual teams and virtual meetings.
Kapil is trying to dial in again. I think there's some
challenge. Sure. In the meantime, what I can do is while Kapil logs in again, he has an audio issue. We could perhaps run a quick poll here, right? So this is for all of you in the audience. I'm sure this is the reality today. We'd like to know, what do you think the future of work looks like, right? Are we all heading back to office? Yay, finally getting back our lives after 2 years? Or is it going to be more hybrid or fully remote? Different organizations have said different things about this. We'd like to know from this audience. We've got about 83 participants. It's a pretty good sample size for us to know what is actually you know, unfolding in front of us. And how many people in your organization work virtually, right? And many organizations that are in critical businesses have a substantial portion of the workforce working in office already through COVID, in fact, right? So we'd like to know how many people in your organization work virtually. And is your organization planning to scale remotely after possibly your experience in the last 18 months, 24 months? Is there a view towards scaling the remote working part? A lot of organizations are thinking about that as well. And lastly, how well has your organization adapted to remote working on a scale of 1 to 5? Can we have answers from all of you?
Rajiv, while everyone does that, are you able to hear me now?
Yes, yes.
I don't know. I mean, I wasn't on mute, but for some reason it...
Yes, the technology gods had a role to play there.
Cool.
So let's wait for the audience to answer these questions. I'm really keen to see what comes out of this. And Kapil, maybe we can start with the answers that we're going to see here. If there are any surprises that we see or things that are expected, I think it'll be good to get your view on what comes out of this audience panel.
Sure.
All right, I hope all of you are answering the questions now. And once we get enough answers, Raghav, I'd request you to end the poll so we can see the results. All right, so the audience has spoken. Question number one, what do you think the future of work looks like? 93% say it's going to be hybrid. Awesome. Second, how many people in your organization work virtually? Again, right? I think 76 to 100% work virtually, right? So I think in this audience, we have predominantly a virtual working kind of an audience. And is your organization planning to scale remote working? Yes, right? 63% of the audience seems to think they are scaling remote working. And how well has your organization adapted to remote working on a scale of 1 to 5? Adapted successfully, 47%, better than expected, 22. So put together, that's about 69%, which seems to think that the organization has, their organization has adapted well to this. That also leaves about, I think 19%, which is saying, you know, we've not figured it out or inconsistent. Industry standard, par for the course, about 13%. Kapil, maybe we'll start with this one. Anything that jumps out at you as a surprise or something you would like to comment on? And coming from BT, this whole move towards work, I'm sure is a good news for BT as a company, right? Because we rely on your infrastructure and services and so on for virtual ways of working. Anything that you'd like to comment on these four questions?
So I think, Rajiv, I mean, the answers seem quite intuitive to me in terms of what all of us have experienced over the last, let's say, 20 months. I mean, almost 100%, like 93% organizations are talking about, or people have responded with a hybrid work, right? And it's a spectrum. You know, even if you have 20% people working virtually versus 80%, I think it depends where your organization's is gonna fall in between. But I believe there are very few extremes right now. So not many organizations are saying 100% virtual. I think it's only a few organizations like maybe, you know, GitLab and, you know, who are trying to do that with a complete distributed workforce. But, and even on the, you know, other extreme, there's very few who are saying no remote working or no virtual working. So I think the answers are quite, you know, quite intuitive. And that's where I think in your last question, it's only, I mean, less than 20% who are saying we're still trying to sort of figure it out, right? Because what's happened in the last 20 months, we've all been forced to come up with a solution that at least works. But I think future is going to be a lot more important. You know, when we will design, we'll finalize what it means for us as compared to, you know, the pandemic forcing everyone to following something.
Awesome. That's a great perspective. So thanks for that, Kapil. So what we'll do now is go back to the script, right? So what I wanted to ask you is, what are the biggest enablers and roadblocks to virtual working today? We experienced one just now. Are you on mute or you're on mute or I can't hear you or MS Teams going down? That's all part of our reality today. But going beyond these technical challenges that we face in virtual ways of working, what are the biggest enablers and roadblocks?
Look, I would say, Rajiv, whatever are your sort of enablers can also be roadblocks in a manner, right? Because if you do them well, you know, they become the sort of biggest enabler. But if you don't do them well, then, you know, then they're a roadblock. But to start with, there's obviously clear, certain very fundamental enablers like technology, infrastructure, connectivity, where telcos play an important part. And not just connectivity, right? But reliable, fast, you know, qualitative connections, you know, which don't go down all the time on, you know, at the right speed. But that's predominantly the starting point. And I think the pandemic over the last 20 months significantly accelerated this enablement and adoption. And I think wherever possible, everyone would have experienced some sort of virtual working, during the pandemic. But I think the most important phase is now, because while the technology has enabled it, you know, people have infrastructure, even though, you know, homes are not made for having a proper office setup, but everyone's figure out, right? I mean, it could be your kitchen table, dining table, you know, bedroom. It's necessity is the mother. I mean, it's the mother of invention, right? I mean, that's what's happened last year. But now is when organizations have to decide what would really smart working, virtual working, hybrid working, whatever you call, mean for them. And I think two biggest things stand out for me in terms of enablers and roadblocks. A lot of organizations would have changed their systems, processes, databases, policies over the last sort of 18 months to figure out, you know, when you actually get out of this pandemic or when you're close to it, you know, would we be ready for a real hybrid working environment? That's one very important thing, because beyond a point in time, you know, technology can't add much, you know, value in terms of what you get out of it. It's the culture, it's the system that makes a, you know, that makes a big difference. And the second important enabler from my perspective is the mindset of the organization and the mindset of people. What's happening in that regard? So when I say mindset of the organization, you know, I'm referring to a lot of organizations let people work from home virtually, but don't trust them as much. Because unfortunately, there's still this underlying connotation that work from home is not really work, you know, at times, or people, you know, do their personal work, you know, during their sort of office hours or whatever. So I think that mindset organization has to change. Also, you can't take the easy option out of saying that we'll only go by certain very intuitive roles, individual contributors, you know, who can work from home, and not enable it for everyone. You have to figure out a way of enabling it for people, then decide, you know, whether it really works or not. And then I think on the employee perspective, the mindset is equally important. You know, you still got to be disciplined, you still got to be productive, you still got to manage risk, all those things that you would do very well while you're in an office environment, and not let the organization think, you know, that those things are changing. And more importantly, also take care of your, you know, of your well-being. And if this mindset prevails over a period of time, then it helps you either sustain the culture that you wanted in the organization or create a culture, you know, that you want. So a lot of everyone's talking about hybrid work or remote working doesn't encourage collaboration, or at least, you know, limits collaboration, limits engagement, limits innovation. So organizations which can figure out, you know, their answer that how can some of these challenges be actually their strength because of the culture, will become sort of the biggest advocates, and in turn will become the biggest enablers of, you know, virtual working, I would say.
Awesome. That's excellent. So you started off with technology, connectivity, reliable connections, and so on. That's sort of the basic, right? If you don't have that, you don't have virtual working, yeah, thing to begin with. But in today's context, everybody has adopted it. There's no way around it. So once those basics are met, now the focus is shifting more towards the systems, culture, leadership, mindset, the softer elements, so to speak, right? Where that's the operating system, which basically connects people with ways of working and what needs to be done. That's excellently articulated. And how do you see the evolution of remote working as you look ahead? I think the poll also revealed something on this front. Yeah. But as you look at it, I've been talking to industry leaders. They are saying, you know, when the opportunity is right, when the employees are ready, we are going back to work in a big way. Because to your point as well, this whole idea of collaboration, innovation seems to be taking a hit, because when you're time boxing everything into a Zoom call, you know, 30-minute call into the small box that we find ourselves in, somehow, you know, innovation is not unlocked, is the perception that, or at least a point of view that people have. So how do you see this evolving? Will the pendulum swing the other way? We see this often in terms of behaviors and how organizations respond. Yeah, what is your point of view on this?
Sure, Raju. I mean, that's a great question, right? And everybody is trying to understand what exactly will happen, or rather, what's the best hybrid remote working model that you can follow, you know, that will give you the best of both worlds, right? I mean, exceed business objectives, but still give people radical flexibility, you know, that they're looking for. So, I mean, in my view, I think, like I was saying, there are all kinds of organizations on extreme ends, you know, whether allowing 100% remote or 0% remote or, you know, somewhere in the middle. I think what will happen in the future is people have now have a view of what remote working means for their organization. And when they try it out, they will understand whether, you know, it's working for them, not working for them. And there's a concept in, you know, in statistics, regression to the mean. I think that will happen in, you know, in remote working as well. So more and more organizations, I think, over a period of time will sort of get closer to the, you know, to the average. And at the cost of, you know, being incorrect, I think it would be 50-50, 60-40, you know, plus minus 10%, here or there. I think that's what eventually it will be. I think more and more, most organizations will have a remote working or a hybrid working culture. It won't be that I'll be either 100% or, you know, I'll say, you know, come back to office at no cost all the time. I don't think that will happen. If organizations do that, most likely, you know, they will not be able to attract the right sort of talent that they would want, or talent would, you know, go to other places, you know, which are giving them those options. I would think, you know, that would happen. I am quite confident, though, that legislation, especially in India, all these things about state labor laws and having one thing across the country, I think those will become enablers, and those challenges, will not remain. And over a period of time, the governments will decide, you know, that's the right thing to do. And the last thing I would say that I believe will also happen is, I think work and personal life will become more and more entwined, like what has happened over the last, 18-20 months. And I think a culture will eventually prevail where, if somebody tells you, listen, I got to step away to drop my kid to school or, you know, do something personal, you're not going to, you'll be very comfortable with it. And you're not going to think that there's something wrong in it. So then it will move towards more, you know, what's important is what work is getting delivered as compared to when it's getting delivered, you know, where it's getting delivered. I think that's what would be the future of at least remote working in the, you know, near future from my perspective.
Awesome. I really like the legislation angle that you brought in. Usually something that we don't think of naturally, right? So today, because of these boundaries going away, somebody sitting here in India can do global work and get paid in Bitcoins, right? So, what happens in those scenarios? So I think that the point is interesting. One, what is the equilibrium for the organization? Where do they want to settle? And for the employee as well, we want flexibility. At the same time, we want engaging work and we want meaningful work. And I think both of these points have to meet at some level.
Yep.
I really like that point you made. So what does it take for an organization to effectively harness the benefits of remote working? You spoke about systems, culture, processes. Anything that you would like to highlight in terms of what you have seen is currently effective in harnessing the benefits of this?
I think, I mean, trusting your employees to do the right thing, I think, is very, very important. Which sets the right culture and mindset in the organization, and gives your people the empowerment to sort of make decisions to ensure that they deliver, you know, at the best pace for the organization. I would say we've all come up with a plan for our world, which we believe will work, but chances are we may have to tweak it, Rajiv, you know, when we experience it over the course of next 6 to 12 months, when hopefully you have the flexibility and COVID's behind us, that you can get 100 people in the office, but you choose not to do that. So I would urge, I mean, even whether it's my organization or any organization, to say, even if your current framework of hybrid working doesn't really give you the results that you're looking for, don't give up on it. Learn from, you know, what's not working, and then try something else. In fact, I believe some organizations are trying multiple models at the same time, so that they could get the best results of that pilot and then implement an overarching organization-wide, you know, philosophy or framework of hybrid working. So for me, it's important to try out different models, then come up, then reach the right solution, create that, you know, right sort of mindset and culture with the people by trusting them. And I think the other two things that will become more and more important, you know, for every organization is diversity and inclusion.
Yeah.
You know, when you're in the office and you still struggle to include people, or you still struggle to be, you know, really diverse, I think this would expedite that pace of progress, you know, in that area. Every organization across the world is trying to become more diverse, become more inclusive. I mean, it's a no-brainer, right? But if you look at the pace of whether it's gender diversity, you know, disability, or, you know, ethnicity, the pace of progress is not that great, despite CEOs, you know, saying it's top of their agenda. Because it is real hard work, you know, to make that change, not just get the talent, but change the culture, you know, within the organization. I think in a distributed workforce or a remote working model, that can be your biggest enabler, or can help you harness the, you know, benefits of remote working if you get that right.
Awesome. So one, you're saying trust is the underlying element, right? And the next one is the whole idea of diversity and inclusion. And which is a pertinent point, right? Because when you are managing a hybrid team with some of your team members here and some remote, and like they say, out of sight, out of mind, if my leader doesn't give all the opportunities to the people in front of him and forgets about not there. So that, you know, sort of brings about some unconscious biases in decision making and all of that. So, and which is in fact, a nice segue to the next question I have. What are some skills and capabilities that you would like, you know, leaders to build for managing virtual teams?
Pick another thing that's happened, Rajiv, that, and we've seen it with all different kind. I mean, with different kinds of people within an organization, is the connect to the organization has either increased or reduced depending upon how you experienced it over the last, you know, 20 months. Now, a lot of new people who've joined different organizations, for them, they haven't felt the culture, they haven't felt the vibe, they haven't felt the physical surrounding where they work. So for them, it's your organization is just a laptop, you know, and the paraphernalia that you've gotten with it. Now, for me, when that connection sort of reduces, what will still sustain the momentum and exceed objectives is the connection with the, you know, with the leader.
Yeah.
Or, you know, with your manager. So it's really important, you know, I think for leaders now to actually be, you know, more intelligent emotionally, to be really more, you know, more empathetic, like you said, be really inclusive, not just think of people who are in front of you, but people who are, you know, who are not even in front of you. I think those things would be, you know, would be very, 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 very important. I think if the leaders set the right expectations, systems, when it comes to, you know, development of people, or how, you know, everyone's equally equipped to deliver the right, you know, objectives for the organization, that will be, you know, that will be extremely important. I would also say, you know, one more thing that, and I've personally experienced this. People believe that, you know, if you obviously spend time together physically, you know, connections can be made faster. And there's no denying the fact that it, you know, they're extremely helpful. But that doesn't mean that if you do have a virtual team who you haven't met or you may not meet for the next, you know, foreseeable future, similar connections cannot be, you know, cannot be developed. In fact, I have seen, you know, we've been able to develop proper great connections, you know, with certain team members who we've never met. It's just, you know, over video. So don't think it is not possible. I mean, it is possible. You just have to, you have to follow those same principles that you do when you're in person with people. You got to be in the moment. You got to listen to them, got to give them the time, sort of space that they need. And, and first understand them before trying to, make them understand your point. I mean, if you follow those basic principles, it will be, you know, similar, and you could still build those, you know, connections.
Awesome. Great, great answer, Kapil. Thank you so much for that. So you straddled a long journey in a very short time, right? From technology to infrastructure to culture, systems, and leadership practices as well. Wonderful answers. Thank you so much, Kapil. I'm sure Kalyan is itching to show us and show off the new product, right? And so over to you, Kalyan. And we'll have a Q&A right in the end. You can ask Kapil some more questions towards the end. Over to you, Kalyan.
Thanks, Rajiv. Thanks, Kapil. Thanks. Those are the really valuable inputs. Okay, let me share my screen. I hope you're able to see this.
Yeah.
Okay, great. So what we'll do next is primarily focusing on the simulation piece, the ones that we promised to showcase you, right? We'll look at the introduction to the simulation, what are the learning and the business outcomes of it. We'll jump into use cases and some competencies that are primarily covered in the simulation. And then we'll come to the exciting part of giving you a quick preview of the sim and also a preview of the report as well. Okay, starting off with the simulation. Now, just like what's the USP of KnowledgeScape, which is primarily around simulation-based learning, or what we call the experiential learning. As part of this methodology, what you typically do, and quite a few people must be aware of this who've been working with us, you basically make the participant or the learner immerse themselves in a certain role, in a certain environment. And you basically pose a lot of challenges that come as part of that role. Now, how you succeed navigating through those various challenges and eventually reach the business outcomes or the objectives that your role demands is what typically forms an experiential learning methodology. Now, this simulation, which is focusing on leading virtual teams, is primarily around that particular topic, wherein you're part of you're leading a globally distributed team. We can call it a virtual as well as hybrid team as well, because there are different scenarios coming through. And how you navigate through these challenges, and what are the different approaches that you take or you should take to reach the goal that you're entitled to, is what forms the crux of the simulation. Now, along with that, we also focus on, are you looking into the aspects of the morale, motivation of these team members, which will directly impact the productivity levels. So those two scenarios are kind of spoken in detail in the simulation and tested in detail in the simulation. Coming to the USP or the value prop of what this typically simulation forms, as the name suggests, one is of course the experiential learning methodology that we talk about. Secondly, it's primarily around creating this culture of how do you ensure that this remote working culture is kind of successfully built in into an organization. That's what takes care of this product primarily. Now, what are the various outcomes? Now, every simulation that we have follows a three-part learning structure or learning methodology that we call it. Now, this is firstly, we talk about learning, which talks to you about what are the different topics, or what are the different elements as part of leading virtual teams. And we give them a brief conceptual kind of a learning to start with. That's the learning aspect. The second is the application, which is when the simulation comes into picture, where you're applying those learning into the simulation or the simulated environment. Last but not the least is the reflection piece. If you've learned something, you have applied something, how do you reflect upon it? What are the things that I should have done, I could have done, and I need to be doing, right? So those are different elements. This is the three-part structure we follow. Now, as a byproduct of this three-part structure is what gives you the outcomes. And we measure them at two different levels. One is from a learner perspective, and obviously more importantly, from a business perspective or the organization's perspective. From a learner perspective, some of the points that come through are, what are these, defining what are these virtual team structures? What are the importance, and how do you understand what are the various challenges that are being faced by the leaders in a virtual scenario, right? We bring those learnings into picture. And secondly, we also give them a certain systematic approach of how to be effective, how to be effective in leading a virtual or a remote, or like I said, even a hybrid team. At the same time, also ensuring that the morale and the productivity is also kind of enhanced and taken care of. Right? This is from a learner standpoint or the learning outcome standpoint. From a business, as we spoke earlier, obviously to build that a culture of virtual working, as well as building those high performance virtual teams, and thereby taking care of certain elements like diversity and inclusion, as well as morale and compliance. And eventually that has an impact on attrition being reduced, a lot more productivity levels coming up, eventually impacting the business outcomes in the organization as well. Now, coming to the use cases, what can where this can be applied. Pretty straightforward virtual teams, and I mean, there's very little to tell here because people are facing this challenge a lot. So I think the people themselves can relate to a lot of use cases that they can quickly kind of put this into. But just to give you a few examples, irrespective of level, it's primarily around leading a certain team. So it can be a first-time manager or even a middle-level manager or leader who is tasked with leading a virtual team spread across different, let's say, locations. Can be geography based, any kind of demographic based, but primarily around leading a virtual team. And like I said, also it also has an impact on not just virtual and fully remote, but also hybrid teams. The simulation covers different scenarios, not just particularly relating to virtual, but primarily on the on the virtual front. Now, last but not the least is an organization level transformation. We are looking at inculcating an kind of an appreciation for virtual teams and how they work. So different use cases that can plug into. And we have various products that can cater to these use cases as well. So one such possible combination or a solution that we can present is where there's leading virtual teams taking care of the virtual scenario. We also have two other simulations which can kind of bolt onto this and create a proper journey. One is around leading teams effectively. This can be a combination of hybrid and virtual working. The leading teams effectively, which primarily focus around different leadership styles that you need to adopt to manage a certain team. Then obviously you're leading virtual teams, which we're going to see in a minute. This can also bolt on to another simulation, which is wherein we use Grow framework to primarily coach your team members to get the best out of them. So just one possible solution or kind of an angle that we wanted to present, how it can bolt together and inform a nice little journey for your transitional as well as transformational purposes. Now that we have seen what the simulation is, what's the USP, what are the various outcomes and the use cases, let's get into the crux of the simulation. What does the simulation do, right? What are the various competencies that get measured? So we've done a lot of research on this. We've seen this is a hot topic in the market, and we've done a lot of research in terms of what are the various challenges, what are the various scenarios that need to be, that a leader would face in a virtual environment, and what they need to do to kind of pass through them, right? Now we've come up with an internal framework called DICED, D-I-C-E-D. Now these cater to different elements, starting with driving for results. As the name suggests, how do you ensure that the team is still working towards those goals that are set, or the goals that are being set? So that's more important, right? So given the virtual environment that you're working under, the core objective or the results that you're being, or the targets that are presented to you have to be met at any cost. So that's first. So how driven for results you are as part of this leading the teams. Secondly, inclusivity. How do you ensure that the team members are being seen, heard, and ensuring that they are being included in different aspects of this virtual world as well. Third comes the communication, basic level. Are you ensuring that the communication is pretty clear, that collaboration or communication piece has to be strong? Last but not the least, the preliminary one would be the empathy. And lastly, the delegation. Empathy, as the name suggests, you need to ensure that you're kind of taking into account the feelings. And when a situation demands, there has to be scenarios when you need to delegate it as well. Okay? So drive for results, inclusivity, communication, empathy, and delegation. These form the different five competencies that we measure in the simulation. Now, without further ado, I'll take you to the core simulation as well, give you a preview, and then we'll be open for taking up any questions as well. Okay. I hope you're able to see this tab as well. Right. Now, like I said earlier, right? So an experiential learning methodology demands three core components. One is the environment or the story that you're being put into. Secondly, the role. And thirdly, the objectives. Now, in this case, we are telling you that you're the story or the virtual environment that we're talking about is about an organization called Jurassic. Okay, a very interesting name, but it's about an automobile manufacturing company, and they're trying to move towards an electric vehicles scenario. But they have two models, T-Rex and Raptor. Right? So this is the story you're putting into it. The story here is about an automobile manufacturing company. Now, what is the second object, second component that I spoke to you earlier about is about the role. Now, you can see here, you are being promoted as the lead of the sourcing team for this automobile manufacturing company. You're being posed with different challenges. There's also the targets have been increased that your tasks with production going to be doubled because you're spreading across different geographies. And there's a certain organization chart, in this case, a team that you have and colleagues and certain set of team that is mainly taking care of the sourcing one. You're here, IKEA, where you're heading the sourcing team. You're based in Manila. The reason I said it works for a virtual as well as hybrid team is, as you can see, there are some people in Manila as well. And you have different other players like the engines, the batteries, the different components that you need to source to ensure you create an automobile. Now, accordingly, they are spread across different geographical locations, all the way from Chennai, Hanover, and all the way down to Mumbai, Dubai. Now, this is what your team forms, where you're heading this. Now, the last and the third part of the experiential methodology that I spoke about is the objectives. Analogous to this particular story that you're looking into, there are two core objectives. These objectives can be accordingly modified based on the story as well. In this story, the two core objectives are, one is the sourcing meter. It's nothing but, because you're looking at an automobile manufacturing company and you're the head of the sourcing department, are you able to get all the sourcing to ensure that you meet at least 70% of the production demand, given that the production demand has also gone up. That's what we've established in the previous scenario, right? That is one. And the second objective is at a team level. You need to ensure that your team's energy levels are at least, in this case, we are rating it on a scale of 1 to 5. It should at least be 3 stars, which gives you an indication that the productive levels can be high as well. Now that we have set the context, the role and the objectives, let's see how are these various scenarios or challenges that are coming across. Now, this simulation is based on an exercise or a format, what we call is an inbox plus call based exercise. So you have different scenarios, challenges being thrown at you in the form of emails, calls. Currently, this simulation caters to these two features. I'll give you a glimpse of 2-3 emails and the call messages to get you a hang of how these scenarios would be. Just like any simulation, there's a complete onboarding process we follow, which talks to you about what are the different elements in the interface to kind of get you acclimatized to the overall interface before you jump into the actual gameplay. As you can see, just like a real world, there are two constraints typically in real world that you operate under, which is cost and time. In this simulation, we are looking at a cost element. So we're giving you a certain time frame within which you need to complete this. In this case, 40 minutes. Okay. Two most important objectives that we spoke about, the sourcing and the energy levels. Different levels of gamification that have been inbuilt when you're playing in a cohort, to bring in that social angle, you're competing against other folks as well. I'll just skip through this basic onboarding in the interest of time and take you directly into the first conversation that has come up. And these conversations, there are about close to 30 odd conversations with multiple threads, different responses having different eventually different emails that are coming up, branching wise, triggers wise, as well as logic wise in terms of based on what responses you choose. And these keep coming up at different times, accordingly in a certain order. Now, let's just look at a couple of emails just to give you a glimpse of what these scenarios are. As you can see, there's a demand that we need to go up, increase the production by 60%, and thereby you'll have to increase your production also by 70%. So there's a new target that's been set. And Ria, who's your manager, kind of is checking with you that hope you'll be able to meet these targets. And she's also bringing up one other point about Lazarus, one of your team member who's not been performing up to the mark. And she's asking you, what are you going to do about this? Will you be reallocating some of these responsibilities? So there's this small challenge that has come up with you in this virtual world, that there's one person who's not performing well. And this can be correlated to even in a hybrid working space, right? Not just primarily virtual. So we'll keep the first through to 2-3 scenarios very simple, just to get a hang of, and that gets a lot more complicated as we move forward. Okay, so what do we do on this? So we look at how do we respond to this in terms of the message. So you got this email that you can see here. Let me just pull this aside. Now you need to reply to this, and you're thrown different options to accordingly decide what is the best possible response to this particular challenge that you post. Quickly telling you some of the options, and I would be happy if people can answer on chat. We'll look at these as 1, 2, 3, and 4. I'll just read you through the options just to make it interactive and see what you think about this. The first option, to give you a quick overview, is about the fact that, okay, that's exactly what I would want to do as this manager. And I'm looking at another person called Biyu, who's been a star performer, and looking. So this talks about dumping the work of Lazarus, who's been your poor performer, onto a star performer. That's the first option. The second option is about, okay, I'll take my time to go through these targets. I'll have a word with the team as well. And regarding Lazarus, who's not been performing up to the mark, I'll have a word with him to understand what is his challenges and what's happening exactly on his front. That's two. Three is more about putting Lazarus on a performance improvement plan. So taking the decision that maybe it's time we'll have to fire him, initially putting on a PIP. Last option is about, I look at these targets, but I'm going to phase them into different levels or different numbers. I'm going to do them in phases. I'm going to announce them one after the other and not taking it all at once. Right? Now, these are the four different options that are thrown at you. If you can hear from the audience, what do you think is the best option here? Should be straightforward. It's about keeping it very simple in the first two scenarios. What do you think is the best option? 1, 2, 3, or 4? If you can just type in the chat. Okay, Meenakshi says 2. Johnny says 4. Okay, I'm seeing a combination of 2 and 4 a lot. Okay, that's good to see. In the interest of time, let's move forward. So what is the best option here, right? So if you look at 2, and these options are kind of connected back to the objectives, which is the sourcing and energy. Depending on what option you choose, accordingly, the metrics will impact. But internally, these options are tied back to our competencies. Now, option 2 is very heavily connected to driving for results, because you're ensuring that the results are met. Whereas, and the second thing is also about inclusivity. You're ensuring that you talk to Lazarus, understand, also have a sense of empathy there. Listen, what is this problem? Now, option 4 is not referring to Lazarus, is not talking about Lazarus primarily, right? But majorly focusing on, and also the targets, if you see, you're splitting them across, not taking the overall targets. So though both of them sound similar and are on the right track, the best option in this scenario is option 2, and we'll see what happens because of that. You choose that option, and you can see the positive impact. Now, one thing to note here is it's not like there's one right and all of them are wrong. There are scenarios where there can be somewhat slightly positive impact, and there can also be an option which has a huge positive impact. Right? Same goes for negative as well. Right? These are some scenarios that we have thrown at you, and you can see there's a response coming from Ria as well. That's a good plan. Now, this is just one particular thread for this email. Now, as you go forward and take a lot more, look into a lot more scenarios, there'll be multiple sets of threads that are going through depending on the option you chose. I'll just take you through one other call kind of a format that I spoke to you. As you can see, there's a response that comes from Lazarus as well, because I've chosen a response which doesn't suit them. That's why you could see a negative as well. Just wanted to give you a glimpse of how that works. This is one such scenario that you can see. Like I said, one is an email and the other one is a call. So this is a call or a chat kind of a window, but the entire story or a scenario is created in such a format that it becomes a lot more flexible and a lot more relatable. And there are different scenarios being thrown at you. As you can see, you need to choose option. You get another set of options, again, based on the response that you have chosen. It's purely dependent on what responses you chose, which means that it's not just branching, but there are multiple levels of threads inbuilt into one such scenario itself. And every option or every decision that you take eventually has an impact, not just on the metrics, but also internally using our data points, we have an impact on the objectives and the competencies. Now, and similarly, like I said, there are multiple scenarios that go on, close to about 30 different conversations, various triggers, various scenarios. a lot of complex challenges that come up as you post, as you move from the 10th email onwards, heavily challenging conversations that come towards you as well. This is how the whole simulation functions across the 30 minutes, different scenarios being thrown at you, all under one bucket. I'll quickly take you through the report, what comes at the end of it. One-click report for every user that undergoes the simulation. Starting with the core objective, what we're looking at, what is the overall leadership score? In this scenario, we're talking about the leadership of a virtual team scenario. And how did you fare on the objectives that you were given? There are certain objectives, whether did you meet them or not? Then comes the interesting aspect, like we were talking earlier, about the five competencies we measure using multiple data points across these 5 different competencies. And we accordingly rate them on a standard scale of 1 to 10 that we follow across all our products, which also helps us in benchmarking and creating multiple analysis out of this. And for each of these competency in particular, not just a static description that is given to you and in terms of what is the best way to adopt, there's a dynamic insight that comes only for you in terms of what is that you have done well and what you should have done for every competency purely based on the score that you have got. And we kind of ended with some takeaways in terms of depending on what your scores are, these takeaways will help you. How do you improve these scores and how do you maintain these learnings as well when you're back on the work? Now that forms the crux of the entire simulation. Hope you got a sense of what the simulation talks about and what are the various intricacies and challenges that are being posed across and how effective and how beneficial it is from an organization standpoint. We'll open the podium or the stage now for more questions. Anyone who have any questions, you can post them on the Q&A section. I'll bring Rajiv also onto this. You can also take up any questions that you have.
Yeah, thanks, Kalyan. That was exciting. For everybody, I'm sure you have questions for Kalyan. Please feel free to ask your questions on the Q&A box. And I see one question there already. Hybrid seems to be the way forward. How do we equip leaders to manage hybrid teams? I understand the simulation talks 100% about remote working. Will it be relevant to a hybrid model? Kalyan, would you like to take that?
Yes. So like I was briefly mentioning during the presentation as well, the simulation not just focuses heavily on the virtual teams, though there's the scenario we speak about where people are geographically spread across. But if you look at one or two scenarios that we've shown, you can see that most of the scenarios are also something that a hybrid team or a regular team would face. Right? While we're putting this in a virtual team context, so it's definitely applicable and can work for a hybrid team scenario as well.
All right. Any other questions? Please feel free to post your questions on the Q&A box. Yeah, I think great questions. I was expecting this one. Thanks, Shantanu, for asking that question. What are organizations doing to prevent online burn? I know some are doing no meeting days, etc. Right. So Nolscape is a good example as well. We do have a no meeting day every fortnight. And the last Friday of every month is an off. Yes, we are hiring, in case you think this is exciting. All right, so Kapil, anything you would like to add to this, right? What are organizations doing to prevent online burn?
I think a lot of organizations are trying different things, like you said, let's say no meeting day, you know, giving people the sort of prerogative to decide when they want to switch on the camera, when they not want to switch on a camera. Sometimes I've realized that a phone call on a mobile in the last 18 months feels actually a lot better than a meeting on Teams or Zoom on the laptop. But I think other than that, there's also with the government guidelines letting us get back in the office, there's also merit in bringing people back in the office, you know, for a little while, for collaboration, for engagement. So rather than just not doing no meeting days, I mean, you could do, you know, meeting in person. You could also be very innovative if people are willing to do this. So what we've also done is you don't have to come to the office, but I could go and meet someone outside. you know, do a meeting like that? Or can two people be in the same, you know, same home if people are comfortable, you know, do that? So anything that helps take their attention off, off the PC. We've encouraged, power hours during the day, step away. So you can't have a water cooler conversation, but could you just step away and do something else because, you know, you're focused on getting the work done. So a lot of such, small things. But I would say getting back in the office, at least when it's allowed to interact and engage with people, works. You know, we have seen it work really well.
Got it. Excellent, Kapil. So Kalyan, would you like to answer this question on who's an ideal target audience for this product?
Yeah. So though it's primarily suitable from an FTM or a middle manager level, it can work across multiple levels. I mean, anyone who has a team to lead, because everyone has the same challenges in terms of leading certain teams. It can be a manager, it could be a manager of managers. So it should work across multiple levels as well.
Great. Thanks, Kalyan. And I realize we have just one more minute. Any last final question? And I see some comments on the chat window as well. Bill says we could use a scenario for production, for efficiency and effectiveness, not just remote working. Yes, that's right, Bill. And Asad Ali says, yeah, so last version of Nolscape's iLead is focused on leadership styles. Can we expect anything from the new version as well? So as Kalyan mentioned, Asad, this is based on the DICED framework, which is an internally researched framework for leading in the virtual world, right? And Kalyan explained what DICED stands for. That is the framework that we will be teaching participants who go through this experience. Yeah, Jenny, I think this recording will be made available on YouTube. I think Hardik and my marketing team will publish this and give you the link post the session. All right, and last and final question, are you interested in talking to a specialist from Nolscape on how we can help you build high performance virtual teams? Please feel free to let us know. There's apparently going to be a poll on this one. Please let us know on the chat window, or if the poll magically appears right now, you can answer that as well. But I'd like to take this opportunity to thank Kapil for his wonderful insights on this topic. Really well nuanced and really insightful. Thank you so much, Kapil, for sharing these insights with us and for participating in this event. Really appreciate this.
No, thanks, Rajiv. Thanks for having me. Thank you.
All right. And thank you all for participating in this event. And don't forget, like Steve Jobs always says, right? Wait, there's one more thing. Right, there's one more launch happening tomorrow, and this is on data-based decision making. Same time tomorrow, 17th November, 11:30 a.m. IST, 2 p.m. SGT. We look forward to hosting you for that session as well. Thank you so much for your participation today. I hope this was useful. And let us know if you'd like us to reach out to you to help you build these crucial capabilities in your organization. Thank you, everyone.